Hello and welcome to the Source of Life podcast, a podcast on water history in the ancient and medieval Middle East. Today we're talking about Mesopotamia, the land between and around the two great rivers of Iraq, the Tigris and the Euphrates. To tackle this topic properly, we are going back in time to the earliest development of agriculture in this region, starting from the early Holocene around 12,000 years ago. We're going to discover why something called a crevasse splay was so crucial to the early development of agriculture, and we're going to find out which river is better, the Tigris or the Euphrates. We will then follow the course of history until the Islamic period and even up till the present day. I am joined by Dr. Ja'far Al-Judhari, Assistant Professor in the Department of Archaeology and Vice Dean of the Faculty of Archaeology at the University of Qadisiyya in Iraq. It's great to have you here, Dr. Al-Judhari. Welcome to the show.
Thank you very much for this introduction. You know, it's an honor and a pleasure to be interviewed by you. Yeah, so I'm happy and ready.
Just before we dive into the details of the history, I'd like to hear a little bit about you. How did you come to work on this subject? What inspired you? What was your sort of journey to this area of research?
I was born in 1977 in a village or a farm in Babylon, which is in the middle of southern Mesopotamia. My mom told me that she gave birth while she was harvesting wheat and barley in the field. I'm one of 12, so a big family. Why I'm bigger, one of 12? Because, you know, farmers need laborers. So I, let's say, grown up and raised up in a farm on the levees of Euphrates, within the palm tree gardens. And, you know, my dad actually always, you know, cultivating and harvesting or growing wheat, barley, you know, and other crops. Yes, we have school, but our main job is a farmer. Did my primary and secondary school at the village, and then I went to city to study geology in Mosul University, and then master, did undergraduate in geology, and then master in geology as well. And then I went to the UK to study my PhD in archaeology, where I had three supervisors. The main was Tony Wilkinson, the great Tony Wilkinson, I say. And then he's, of course, archaeologist. And then Mark Allen, he's a geologist. And then when Tony Wilkinson died, actually, Graham Phillip took over. So let's say I'm half geologist, half archaeologist, and 100% farmer. Yeah.
You're one of 12. Where do you fall in the family? Are you
third. I'm the third.
The third oldest.
Yeah, the third. Okay. Yeah. And we are lucky. All of us actually became nearly PhDs.
Okay.
I'm in archaeology, the other in agriculture, the other in geography, and one in fine art. And the other one actually just accepted in master. So, yeah, I mean, you see the story. So even if we have a farmer background, but of course, we became more educated.
Yeah. Yes, and you said that you grew up on the levees of Mesopotamia. So I guess we're going to start talking now about the structure of the environment. So what characterizes Mesopotamia, I guess, over the long course of its history? Now things are very different with modern dams and things like that. But historically, what did Mesopotamia look like? What did its rivers look like? And what are the main features that we should know about to understand what we're going to be talking about?
Yeah, well, I grew up in the area and I saw my parents and my village actually fighting the river. So I will choose the term fighting because it is the only phrase that I can say about the people and the river. And always the river actually fight back. People actually use the river, the water of the river, and then for their advantages. But and sometimes there is lots of fighting between the farmer and the river. Anyway, my understanding of South Mesopotamia is that we have in the early Holocene, we have aggressive, huge, and so fast movement of Tigris and Euphrates that people cannot actually control them to do farm or irrigation. And that's why we don't have, let's say, settlement in that time. We have settlements, and you know, we found lots of archaeological settlement around Mesopotamia, but not within the Mesopotamia, South Mesopotamia, I mean. So the idea is that we have unstable, aggressive, fast moving, evulsive, lots of change, Tigris and Euphrates. But you know, the climate change, and let's say after early Holocene, everything became more stable, and the water, the amount of water that Tigris and Euphrates receive became less. And now we have, let's say, a good environment for people actually to use the Tigris and Euphrates. And then we have lots of evidence. People came from the north, skilled at least, skilled how to divert the water. And then when they became living in southern Mesopotamia, they were able to use Tigris and Euphrates.
So that's the early Holocene, you say.
Early Holocene,
a transition period. For those who don't know, what is the dating of that roughly?
Yeah, well, let's say the Holocene is the last 10 or 12 or even 15,000 years ago. So not a precise time, but let's say between 15 and 12,000 years ago.
Right. So that's also more or less the time that we see a transition, the first transition from hunter-gatherers to agriculture and settlement.
Yeah, and of course, climate change and environment behind that. Otherwise, we cannot actually have settlement in southern Mesopotamia if we have so aggressive rivers. I mean, maybe this is a new, but this is my understanding, actually. We have several examples around the world when we have unstable river, then people cannot, even in Iraq, right now, there are some areas when the river actually changing itself so much, nobody actually used that river, right?
But and what is the problem with the, so I understand the changing river path makes it difficult because if you build a settlement there, then the next year it can be washed away.
Yeah.
And the force of the river also is a problem. You can't irrigate land if the stream of the river is too fast.
Exactly. You can't break the levees to get the water. You know, we have, let's say, a gravity flooded irrigation system. We use the gravity, actually. We don't use, let's say, a water pump or to elevate the water. So I saw Tigris, for example, of course, was running faster than Euphrates. And I saw how it's so difficult to manage the water or break the levees and then get the water out for irrigation. It's really difficult. So that's why I insist that if we don't have a stable and quiet river, then we don't have settlement and irrigation at all. So this point should be taken into account when we deal with the start or the early starting of using the rivers. Unfortunately, I read lots of papers saying that, you know, they don't come to this issue. They think, okay, Tigris and Euphrates are the same as they now. Of course not. actually. Yeah. They were so aggressive. And even sometimes it's scary, actually. I saw myself how the water actually, let's say, erosion the levees, and the levees collapse again. It's a scary scenes, I mean.
Yeah.
So you see the problem.
You've used this word levee several times. So that is the raised sides of the river. How does
that
work?
the two banks of the river, always higher than the surrounding area. You see.
Why are the banks of the river higher than the surrounding area?
Yeah, because when we have flooding, actually, so water actually raise up, and then soil and other sediments settled on the other side of the river, and then with the water down, then we have actually the sediment still deposited by this. I mean, alongside the river. So with repeating things, then we have two levees higher than the elevated, higher than the surrounding area. This is a unique issue with southern Mesopotamia, because in the northern part of Mesopotamia we don't have levees, and always the water actually deep in valleys or something like that. So water is not above the surrounding area in northern Mesopotamia. In southern Mesopotamia, we have, I call it the hanging water. So water is above the surrounding area. Whenever you break the levees, then actually the water come and destroy the land. Well, we have a complicated issue here when we deal with the differences between Tigris and Euphrates. And to me, actually, I see Euphrates was used for irrigation and settlement 2/3 time of Tigris. So let's say Tigris was, let's say, less used, and why actually? I can name more than 20 important sites was actually built by Euphrates, right? Not Tigris.
And why was the Euphrates so much more popular as a site for settlement than the
Tigris?
Yeah,
we can return to the start of our conversation about the quietness, the aggressive, the unstable. Tigris is unstable and aggressive. Huge amount of water. The gradient is high. The amount of sediment is high. And the velocity of the water is high. But Euphrates, everything is better in Euphrates. So quiet, the amount of water is low, the amount of sediment is low. And so it looked like Tigris actually building the floodplain, right, the basin. And then when we have land, Euphrates come and irrigate the land. So that's why 2/3 of South Mesopotamia was irrigated by the quiet, the fresh, the nice water Euphrates, rather than Tigris. This is another issue. Nobody actually discussed that. With Babylon, Ur, Urido, Lagash, Gerso, any other site, even Baghdad, by the way. Baghdad's located by Euphrates, but by Tigris, but irrigated by Euphrates.
Yeah.
Wasit and Kut and other area, even Ctesiphon, Seleucia, the Sasanian or Parthian cities, actually, they were built by, close to Tigris, but was irrigated by Euphrates. So this is another issue in southern Mesopotamia. So yeah.
So as a farmer, if you take the decision to break the bank, break the levee to allow water to flow onto your fields, that's great if you can do that, but it can be too much. That's the idea, that you if you have a small flow of water, you can control this, yes, and it will go where you want it to go. But if it's very fast, then it's too much for
exactly. This, yeah. And now we have here actually a really important point. There is a feature called crevasse play. This is a new term, maybe, but it's a crevasse play when the water actually came out across the levees naturally, not by human beings doing. So imagine we have levees and then the water actually came out naturally. Then we have similar to farm, right? A farm. People actually, when they came from the north or whatever came from, they used crevasse play as a first place to do farming or to build their settlement close to the water. Why? Because the normal fluctuation of the water can go and back from the crevasse play to the river. So they need a little effort, I mean, the people, or the people who live close to these rivers need, let's say, a little effort to control or to manage the crevasse play and then make farm. So the farming idea starts from here, which is...
So if I can clarify then, a crevasse play is a point where the water naturally breaks out from the levee, yeah, and then people come and find this area. They see that it naturally irrigates a little area of the floodplain beneath the river.
Yeah.
And then they can use that, but they guide it? You're saying that they guide it, they begin to understand?
Yeah, they start to manage the water, actually, because they were able to block the opening or the mouth of this crevasse play and then manage the water.
And so this is the earliest phase, then? You're saying... Yeah. This happened sort of 10,000 years ago.
Exactly. When people have no skills, have no city, have no idea to how to control the southern Mesopotamia. Just we need two or one household to do this. So it's so easy job. If you have domesticated animals, then you can actually control the crevasse play and then use your skills to farm or to control this area. So you see the early starting of farming in South Mesopotamia. I think this is the first point, right? Yeah. Rather than, you know, people came with a skill and then dig and then do farm. It's not that easy, by the way.
Yeah. And there's no rainfall here, right?
Or not at all. No rainfall. No, we have, but it's not for irrigation, enough for irrigation. And we don't have water spring. The groundwater is salty. So we only rely on the manageable Tigris and Euphrates.
Yeah. So let's move forward a little bit. So this is the very earliest phase. We've talked about the crevasse plays and the sort of management of a natural phenomenon. How do we get to then these early cities, or we call them cities now? I guess they're not really huge areas, but anyway, a more dense population. Places that, like the names you mentioned, Uruk, Babylon. Yeah. How do we get from these very little kind of breakages in the levee to more sustained irrigation that can sustain these bigger cities?
Yeah, we need
the next milestones.
Exactly. So we need two things: one, population. We need more labor, and we need knowledge or skills, right? So if we have two things in any place, skilled population, then they're actually we're able to build their community or society, or I mean to build their cities. So we think from this beginning of managing the crevasse play, people start to gain or to pass generation after generation to pass the knowledge to others. And because people settled and know how to manage the crevasse play, then we have population. So we have the right thing, skilled population. Then people actually start to dig 2 or 3 kilometers canal and then do farming. Then we have the required resources of the people, which is wheat, barley, and other vegetables. Then people actually became more skilled and more organized, and then they were able to dig for the first time out of the crevasse plain. Then they dug, they managed to break the levees. Now it is manual rather than naturally breaking levees. So they dug for the first time a little canal across the levees, and then they irrigated a new farm.
And when did this happen, this manual breaking? Can we know? I imagine that dating these formations is difficult, but can you?
Yeah, but we can actually, we are still within the 10,000.
Okay.
Yeah, so it's still early Holocene.
Still early.
Yeah. And then, you know, now we have the early states in South Mesopotamia, which is, you know, early Ubaid, I mean, start of Ubaid, and then, of course, the city-state started, and then the issue of water, the milestone is when we have what we now call the Ministry of Water Resources or Ministry of Irrigation. So I think in the past, yes, they recruited some people and their main job was only managing the water. They are not joining the army. They are not joining the farm. They are not working with other things, only busy with managing the water. So these group of people actually were responsible of modifying or inventing or expanding the irrigation. So they have only one job, right? Rather than do three job or four jobs one time. You cannot actually be in the army or in the temple and then, you know. So we have the Ministry of Water Resources between the products. And now actually, when we have this, okay, now we are able to build dam, which is the other milestone. So the first milestone was actually when people managed the crevasse plain. And then the other one, when the people actually started to dig three or expand this crevasse plain for 2 or 3 kilometers. The other one, when they break the levees for the first time. And now we have the Ministry of Water Resources. Then, of course, people were able to build the first dam, right, to raise the water and to irrigate their farm. So you see the story from the beginning. I'm telling you about that. And then, of course, the canal became 10 kilometers or 15 kilometers and long. Then we have a new land, we have fertile land, and then we have more skilled population. Even the job of managing the water became more important than joining the army or joining the temple or doing any other job in that time. Then we have, of course, it became a state responsibility rather than people responsibility, managing the water, because it's source of life, source of wheat and barley, source of everything. And then actually people managed to dig longer and wider canal, and we ended up in the Sasanian period when we have the Nahrawan, started from Samarra, ended in Kut, which is more than around 400 kilometers. So you see how people actually started from managing the small crevasse play and ended up with the Nahrawan canal, which is so long and wide canal. So you see the story. I mean, of course, lots of things going on between the 1 kilometer crevasse play and the 400 kilometers Nahrawan. Of course, lots of things actually between these two major things. So if we have, let's say, a fascinating title, we can say from the crevasse plain to the Nahrawan.
Yeah.
This is the story of Southern Mesopotamia.
Yeah. That's interesting. And it's one of the things that's fascinating about this is this interplay between local communities even households sorting out their own concerns, managing their own farms, and this communal level, people grouping together, I guess, to maintain things, and then the level of the state.
Exactly, yeah. And sometimes, you know, when we have a one state controlling the southern Mesopotamia, rather than two or three states inside, because a river actually has no border. So when we have some part of Euphrates belong a state and the other part from the same river belong another other state, of course, there's a conflict about that. And we can read the history about the conflict over the water in southern Mesopotamia between this state and the other state, maybe the famous one between Lagash and Uma. And
so when do we first see a single state controlling the Tigris and the Euphrates down the length of southern Mesopotamia?
Yeah, the full picture about controlling southern Mesopotamia started from Parthian and Sasanian. We don't have any clue about conflict within these two cities. But the rest, we have some conflict. Even sometimes, you know, we have the sea land, which is the southern part of southern Mesopotamia, when people actually have some conflict with the central government. We don't have something like that in the Sasanian. That's why the Sasanian actually were... let's say the maximum using or you know, controlling of the irrigation was in that time during the Sasanian period. Yeah.
So this is immediately before the Islamic conquest, the 5th, 6th, 7th centuries of the Common.
Exactly. Era. Yeah. So when the collapsing of the Sasanian, it's the start of declining everything until now. So the peak was during the Sasanian period, and then the peak started to decline from the collapsing of the Sasanian, and it's still declining actually until now.
So I'd like to come back to decline in a second, but first, you've mentioned quite a lot about the exploitation and the use of water. What about defense against it? And we mentioned this a little bit with the idea of the fast river and the slow river, the governable and non-governable rivers. But we also, I'm assuming we have problem with flooding and moving, changing courses all through this period. So did they find ways of dealing with the river? How did people deal with the potential dangers of living close to these rivers?
Well, I can give you an example from my own experience. During the, let's say, American action to Iraq or the Kuwait-Iraq war and then American involved, actually, we lived in a time in that there was no government at all. So all the dams and irrigation system actually became out of the government. So Tigris and Euphrates and their branches became more free, right, rather than controlled. Then we have actually one canal dried out and the other canal actually flooded because of the water, of course. So I see myself in South Babylon, the main river actually start to flood while the other canal actually started to dry out. Then we, the people, without any power from the government, the local people, we don't have, let's say, machines because we don't have fuel at that time. So we manage with our own shuffle, small shuffle, to control these things, right? So we dug another canal from the main Euphrates to feed the drying one, the going to dry canal. And we managed actually to irrigate our farm. And I remember when we put sandbag to improve the levees of the main Euphrates. So you see, when people have no government, how can manage the huge Euphrates and Tigris? I imagine in the past, of course, there were a government every time, but they cannot do everything. So people actually, they have the required skill to manage the main Euphrates and the canal that come through it or from it. But in one point of the time, actually, people actually can easily lose control. And they happen, I mean, flooding and dryness, it's happened actually every time. And that's why when we go to literature, we saw lots of stories about the flooding and the dryness about that. But people actually managed to regain their farm after everything settled, so they can dig another canal. And I saw lots of sites in Iraq. When we excavate, we have a period of occupation, and then a missing period, and then another period, and then a missing period. So the main thing of missing or thriving period is, of course, water. When we have change, then, of course, people actually move to another city. And if we have a holy city, then all the state put their effort to keep water close to the city. And they dig actually another canal or new canal to feed the area. The best example of that is Uruk, actually. Uruk was lived for more than 8,000 years, right? With no any cutting or any absence, right? So how can we live in one city for this continuous 1,000 years? Actually, because, you know, Uruk is a holy city for most of the people. And then people actually, whenever, even if we have a river change or the main canal or the main river dried out, people actually can find another source of water. They can dig a canal from the new river and then feed Uruk. This happened with holy cities, Nippur, Uruk, Ur, Babylon. So people actually don't give up and leave the big city. They fight. Again, this term actually is, you can use it again, fight. So they fight to river to bring him back sometimes, or to push him away, push the river away.
This is the city related to the Epic of Gilgamesh. Is that correct?
Yeah, of course, before that. And, you know, yeah. Uruk was, you know, even from, let's say, after Ubaid until the Islamic period. So 8,000 years of occupation there. So all the civilization in Iraq, actually, Uruk was there. And I can see, I published a paper about that, and I can see, I can show you the irrigation network around Uruk and how people, even actually to me, they used Tigris water to irrigate Uruk, even if it's far away from Tigris. So you see the story when they have a precious or really holy city, they fight and they irrigate it. Of course, they will give up if for small cities, small towns. They just leave it and then back again when they're. So then my point is, the main player in southern Mesopotamia was a river. Whenever they change their course, of course, people follow them to build their cities.
Just to summarize, it sounds like if there is danger from the moving course of the river, flooding and these kind of things, and the fact that one branch of the river will silt up and the river will find a new course, then there are two responses. One is to run away, and the other is to fight to keep your position. And it sounds like this decision is in some ways practical, but also cultural, that you have, or I guess a city has a cultural or a religious value, but also maybe it's just a larger number of people who are willing to fight. So that
religion. Well, in South Mesopotamia, we were /are producing religions. We still producing religions. Yeah, we are good at that. So we produce the three main religions, and we have, of course, hundreds of small religions. So religions maybe I can say 50% behind anything, any achievement in southern Mesopotamia. Unity, states, even, you know, skills or anything. It's look like when we have, when the modern people actually were looking for finding gold, right? And they found other minerals, right? So the main aim is finding gold, but accidentally they found the rest of the minerals, right? So the main aim was religion in southern Mesopotamia. And accidentally they found the state, they found, they invented lots of things. So religion is a guiding or something that can actually develop the southern Mesopotamia. So I will give you another example, the modern example. We have Najaf and Karbala, right? Two holy shrine. This shrine actually belong to the grandson of the Prophet Muhammad, right? So they, you know, from the early Islamic, we have these two shrines. Unfortunately, their location is a really difficult location in terms of irrigation. To say they are far away from Euphrates, but people actually tried to dig canal from the main Euphrates to feed these two cities. Why? Because these two cities are holy cities. They need to be irrigated, and you know. During the last 1,000 years, people actually did their job in terms of irrigating to these two cities, and at the end, actually, they managed to change the main course of Euphrates from its own natural course to a new one because of these two cities. So we have I wrote a paper about that. We have a modern example how religion can guide the people to change the water courses. So imagine this is the now. I imagine the same things in the future when we have holy Uruk, holy Nippur, holy Babylon, holy any city. Of course, people will not give up. So when people actually gather, they can make a huge force that can actually control the nature. So that's why actually religion and you know in terms of economic and population, these two cities after 2003, because of the political change, these two cities became the most two thriving cities in Iraq right now. So more than Baghdad and Babylon, by the way. Of course, Babylon, Baghdad, my city, is older than them. I mean, in terms of everything. But because of the religion, now Karbala and Najaf and their people, actually, of course, leading Iraq.
I'd like to go back, yeah, though, now, before we say any more about this, the Islamic period. you pointed to the really remarkable scale of the irrigation works under the Sasanians with this Nahrawan canal stretching 400 kilometers. Can you tell me more about this? So this is the high point in the 6th and 7th century of the Common Era under the Sasanian Empire, who are based in their Persian Empire, but so they are in Iran as well, but they are based in Ctesiphon, which is part of Iraq. So what did this look like, this high point of irrigation in Iraq at this time? What major structures?
Yeah, as I mentioned earlier, if we have population and the skills, right, then we can do everything. So during the Sasanian period, we have the population controlled by one state, so there was no conflict, right? This is the important thing. And then they gained actually during the time the required skills. Then of course we have the two main condition to construct the irrigation and of course to control Tigris and Euphrates, and they did. The evidence that I can provide you about how we can have one peaceful state. You see, the Sasanian settlements in southern Mesopotamia, actually, they are the most. We have 100 and 1,000 of Sasanian settlements. And this settlement has no city wall, right? For example, each city, I can name you 20 cities of the old, pre-Sasanian. Maybe these cities actually were city, they have city walls. Why we don't have that thing during the Sasanian? We have just a group of villages. There were no city wall because they were living in peace. There was no conflict inside the cities. They were not afraid of from enemy coming from outside to attack them. So imagine it's really normal and peaceful to live by the river with your own. And that's it. We don't need to more defensive. So that's why during the Sasanian period, we don't have much walled or defensive cities. So people live in one state peacefully. There was no conflict. And that's why they thrived, in terms of population. And there's no boundaries between states or districts. That's why they have one state and one land, skilled people. And then they managed to do dam. Damming is really important milestone when people block the main river. You still there? Yeah, so people actually blocking or damming the main river and then divert the water through a digging canal. So that's why.
What kind of structures were used to dam the rivers? Because now we're talking about quite large scale. This is not just a small village operation. Yeah. This is quite a large scale diversion in the course of the water. So, what kind of technological processes? Is this just getting a lot of rocks and?
Yeah, exactly. Rocks. Mud, yeah,
they. Is it more than that?
Yeah, well, in the south, we don't have rocks, so we used reeds, right? Bunch of reeds, good, wrapped up together. And I can send you a picture about that. And we used, actually, when we lost the government in 1990s during the American sanction. So we used reeds, actually, and sandbag to control the river. In southern Mesopotamia, they used reeds, which is really active, let's say, material to dam the river. And then, of course, the trees, palm trees, and even oak and another trees can be brought from Levant, Syria and Lebanon through Tigris River. And we have evidence about that when during the Ottoman period, they brought lots of wood from Syria and Lebanon to Babylon to dam another river. So, yes. And then, of course, rock. And then, of course, in a dam, there was some point to need stronger than reeds and trees, wood. They use, of course, metals, actually, rock and metal to join the rocks and built the dam. Okay, so we managed to build the dam. Then how can we actually dig the river? They use shovels, they use animals, they use not, of course, machine. We don't have machines, but shovels and animals actually were able to dig canals. Of course, they use water because, they can open the water in the canal, and then, of course, water can make the soil most fragile and, of course, wet, and then they actually can dig more. So we have two armies, the Ministry of Water Resources, as I mentioned, and then the army actually can contribute. So the government has nothing to fight, only to build or dig a canal. That's why they managed to actually to dig a Nahrawan, and people actually realized how the irrigated farm were essential for their life, rather than relying on the rain irrigated farm, which is actually, you know, we can gain little wheat and barley from the rain fed irrigated farm rather than the water irrigated farm, the river water irrigated farm. So that's why they put their effort actually to dig the Nahrawan. And of course, not only Nahrawan, by the way, hundreds of small canals, I can assure you that they dug during the Sasanian period. Yeah.
And so we have a situation where rather than people just living next to the natural course of the Tigris or the Euphrates, there is a large, much greater extension of agriculture and therefore an increasing population. And I suppose the one builds on the other. The more agriculture you have, the more population you have. The more population you have, the greater number of people you have to maintain these complicated and labor-intensive networks of irrigation canals.
Yeah, exactly. But the interesting point is that the main cities actually still were built by the natural rivers, close to the natural rivers, rather than canals. That's why we in Nahrawan, even if it's long and large, but we don't have important cities by it, right?
Yeah.
So still villages, people managing the river. But, you know, of course, most of the cities, they were still actually living by the natural Tigris and Euphrates.
Yeah. Well, I guess there are things in cities other than agriculture that you need water for. That there are industries, there's drinking water.
Yeah.
And do we see this in your work? Have you what other kind of facilities in these ancient cities do we see in the agricultural record?
Well, if I understand your question well, actually, water sometimes is part of the religion rather than just drink and irrigation.
Yeah.
And for example, I can give you, we have Islam and there are some sectors in Islam. One of them actually saying that even Tigris and Euphrates was a wedding gift for the granddaughter of Muhammad. So you see how can people actually interpretate the existing of water. And we have another religion, not Islam, another religion where the mainly things in their religion is water rather than any other things. And then there sometimes they do practice and worship inside the water and so on. So the other part of using water, river water, was religion, actually. And of course, people need water for sometimes gardening. I mean, gardening for, leisure thing rather than irrigation, when defenses, of course. When people have, let's say, a precious city, then they dig a trench and they feed that trench with water. And we have, I wrote about that one in a paper about that one, where Khandaq Shabur was a Shabur trench, which is a long trench dug in the western part of southern Mesopotamia between the western desert and the floodplain. It's similar to the Nahrawan things. Nahrawan actually was dug in the eastern part of southern Mesopotamia, but Khandaq Shabur was dug in the western part of southern Mesopotamia. But the main thing for Khandaq Shabur was a defensive purposes to prevent the nomadic people, the Arab, come and invade the village, the villagers or the farmer in the southern Mesopotamia. So that one actually was a trench in a dry land actually dug, but in some places they were managed to feed it with water. to make it more complex, actually, to be to work, I mean, as a defensive things. So people, water cannot be used only for irrigation and drinking. The water can use both for religious things and defensive things.
Yeah, and I believe that also cutting the canals has been used as an attack strategy.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, yeah. Well, we have lots of example about why. Because it's hanging water, water above the land. That's why when you break the water, only water can come and flood the cities. ISIS actually used that. ISIS, when they came to invade Iraq, actually, they used this technique. So they threatened the area, the people, of breaking the levees and flooding. And it's happened, actually. They flooded some area in north of Babylon, by the way. So water can be used as a weapon now and in the past, of course. And we have lots of stories about the king order to flood this area by ordering the soldiers to break the levees. They have the knowledge that we have a water running higher than the farm. So they have this idea in their mind. So we can use this phenomenon or advantage or criteria to flood the cities rather than irrigating that. And of course, we know Baghdad flooded several times during the early Islamic or even Sasanian, because of Tigris actually running higher than the surrounding area. So whenever we have flood, Baghdad actually flood. By the way, there was no flooding in Euphrates, right? Only Tigris bringing the bad news. So that's why, I can talk 12 hours about the differences between Tigris and Euphrates and why people actually in the Islamic text, right, and the Arabic text, they mention 10 things, 10 nice things about Euphrates and 20 bad things about Tigris, right? So they say, for example, Tigris is fresh water. Yeah, so I mean, they say lots of things about Tigris, actually. For example, they say Tigris was stormy, was moody, aggressive, evulsion, crazy, muddy, harsh, bad omen.
Let's move back to this idea of rise and decline. And then I would like to just return to asking you a little bit more in detail about your own current projects and your research methods. But before that, you said that the Sasanian Empire was a period of the peak of the extent of the irrigation system in Mesopotamia, and then we see a decline. Can you just tell us what that decline looks like from the point of view of an archaeologist? What is this? Is there are fewer settlements, or there are canals that are falling out of use? And do historians or archaeologists have any theories about what caused this decline?
Yeah, actually, when we say decline, it's declining of, it's we have more abundant or unused canals, right? So we have a huge canal and used in one time. And we have lots of abundant canals. We have land unirrigated. We have decline in number of settlements. So when we count, let's say, Ur 3 period, or we count how many sites belong New Babylonian period, we found less sites or settlements. And then suddenly we have a huge amount of sites belong one period. This is the thriving area and declining area when we have abundant. We don't have sites or canals. So during the Sasanian period, we have the peak of the huge amount of sites and canals, and suddenly these canal became out of use, and then this site abandoned. The people left immediately, and we don't have any clue of Islamic settlement. During the Sasanian period, right, it was thriving. They managed actually to reach every part in southern Mesopotamia, every part. I can show you my map. They went everywhere with their settlements and with their canalization, with their irrigation network. And we have two things. The climate change. It's when we have a dryness or flooding, destroying the infrastructure, the water, the network, the irrigation network infrastructure. That's happened several times in the Sasanian period. But they managed to recover because they have their own people. But once upon a time, which is at the end of the Sasanian period, when we have a flooding destroying the infrastructure of the irrigation network, and then we have disease actually in the same times. So people cannot resist two things, flooding and disease. So that's why the Sasanian Empire became so weak.
So it sounds like the decline, the seeds of decline were there towards the end of the Sasanian period, that you had this combination of disease and flooding, which then were involved in the successes of the Islamic conquests. And then the decline continued during the Islamic period. I guess the center of government moves away from Iraq at that point. You have a caliphate that is based first in Medina and then later in Damascus. And it's not until the Abbasid period in the 8th century that you have a return of power to Iraq. Do you see a increase in investment, or is there any archaeological evidence for the return of wealth or the return of interest into the investing in the irrigation system in Iraq in the Abbasid period, or it's too difficult to narrow down the dating? I guess for archaeology, it's difficult to be exactly accurate or on the dating unless you have some coin or something which gives you a
when the Sasanian Empire collapsed, of course, we have, let's say, unstable irrigation system. Everything actually, you know, it's like an earthquake and then Iraq is so difficult to be managed, and that's why we have another capital of the Islamic Empire. In Medina or in Damascus.
So what are you working on? What are you working on now? Are there some particular exciting things that you're motivated to find out? What are the big questions that are still unanswered in this field? And
maybe two things. One, most of the Western archaeologists, they saying that salinity, you know, the salt water or the salt soil, salinity behind declining civilizations. This is a myth, actually. To me, as a farmer, as a person who knows very well the the land and the water of South Mesopotamia. I don't believe salinity is a main cause or a problem of declining any city in southern Iraq.
Okay. So when you look at soil samples that you've taken on archaeological digs, you don't layers of salt that stop.
Salt, yes, there is a salt. There is a salinity in Iraq, but it's not an issue, not a big issue, not a big deal. So people actually, we have the Sumerian Empire or the Babylonian Empire was destroyed because of the salinity. It's unbelievable things. Please don't say that. So this is that I'm now actually dealing within maybe the next 2 or 3 years, dealing with a project to convince the Western archaeologists that no, salinity wasn't the problem. Flooding and disease, maybe, rather than salinity. And the other thing is that we have a series of water spring, fresh water spring, between the floodplain and the desert in the western Iraq. More than 200 active fresh water spring, and these water springs actually has its own impact on the southern Mesopotamia. We have a slope here from the western desert here and the southern Mesopotamia, right? And then within these two things, we have in the middle, we have 200 freshwater spring, and naturally actually flowing and running. And these water springs must be used by the people even before the idea of crevasse play.
Okay.
Yeah, so I'm dealing with complicated things, but I think it will change the stereotype of...
So your hypothesis is that there must be some settlement around these, early settlement around these springs.
Because water spring is manageable compared with the aggressive Tigris and Euphrates, right?
Yeah,
so it's a complicated story, but I'm working on it with Australian professor and, of course, some professor from Durham University. Yeah.
Sounds wonderful. We look forward to hearing the results about that. Just before we finish, I'd like to ask a more general question. And in a way, you've been talking about modern issues throughout this conversation. So I'd just like to maybe focus more specific on the contemporary modern end of things. What kind of lessons do you think we can learn from historical research? What can we learn about sustainability and about water management for now? Is there something that we can draw from these ancient examples?
Exactly, yeah. So to me, actually, if we fully understand the past, right, without any bias or fear or favor, we will actually use the past. We can use the past to enhance our modern life. And I can see some continuity. Nothing changed to me as a geologist, archaeologist. I can see nothing changed. Even it's just repeating things. The ISIS came and destroyed part of Iraq with a religious mentality supported by the West, maybe. It's similar when the Byzantines recruited the nomadic people and attacked the Sasanian. And then if we go to the past and then the past, you see, when we lost the government in 1990s, the people actually start for their own. I'm sure there is something similar in the past when the people of South Mesopotamia lost the state and government and tried their own to do. So lots of things to be, there are lots of lessons actually we can learn from history. So that's why we, archaeologists, geologists, historians, we should digest history very well and prepare a nice meal for the decision makers, for the public, actually. We reach them and then feed them, and then actually we can... I'm academics and I'm living with academics most of my life, but we should not talk to each other. When I write a paper, it looks like I'm writing to my colleagues. I should write for the public. I should write for the prime minister and the ministerial board.
Yeah.
I should write for the MPs.
So what do you think now are the greatest issues or challenges for water in Iraq? What are the messages that you feel that the public and politicians...
Yeah, unfortunately, my generation, they may see the beautiful, the historic Tigris and Euphrates are drying. After maybe 15,000 years, all the Holocene, Tigris and Euphrates was thriving and running and destroying things. But now I can see Tigris and Euphrates themselves dying. It's really crying things and really annoying things, yeah, to me and to my, of course, to the Iraqi people. Why? Because of politics of, and, of course, climate change. We have Turkey, I mean, building dams and cutting and preventing water to come to Iraq and contributed so much to dryness of southern Iraq. And we have, you know, the climate change, of course, and we have mismanagement of water. We have unfunctioning government in Iraq that doesn't deal with water management as the Sasanian people do, actually. So we have climate change, politics, and unfunctioning Iraqi government. These three things will contribute so much to drying, killing Tigris and Euphrates.
Absolutely. Yeah, well, these are really important things to think about and things that... Really, I guess from your what you've been saying throughout this episode, this picture where you see small communities managing their water resources and then interlinking with a larger state, a greater state authority that has a sort of management role, there needs to be some way of restoring both that local level of...
Yes.
Of really working with rather than with the resources rather than necessarily against them, and also, as you say, this political and now not just state but interstate international cooperation to really to restore this amazing resource.
Yeah, I mean, Euphrates and Tigris, they are not Iraqi only; they are human. I mean, the humanity or the I think all the human beings in the world are feeling in one way or other they are their rivers. So it's the source of life there. The civilization started from there. I mean, the world is, you know, is owing Tigris and Euphrates much, and we should do something.
Absolutely.
To me, actually, I'm doing at least research. This is the only thing that I can do. And the most important thing is how to reach the community in Iraq.
Well, I think you made an important point that, you know, what can we do? Well, one of the things we can do is research, because I guess the first point is understanding, right? If we can understand the problems.
Yes.
So,
yes.
And I'd just like to say very much thank you for your research then, and thank you for talking to us. It's been a really enlightening session.
Thank you very much.
That's all from us today. Thank you for listening.